I'd now like to introduce our moderator and discussion leader for our keynote lecture, Nadeem Shahadi, who is the director of the Ferris Center for Eastern Mediterranean Studies here at the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. Mr. Shahadi comes to us from London, where he remains an associate fellow of the Middle East and North Africa program at Chatham House, the Royal Institute of International Affairs. In addition to his scholarly achievements, Mr. Shahadi brings more than 15 years of experience as an advisor to EU government, European institutions, and international organizations in drafting foreign policy and assistance strategies for the Middle East and North Africa. And he is currently a senior member of St. Anthony's College, Oxford, where he served as director of the Center for Lebanese Studies from 1986 to 2005. As well as a member of the executive board of the Centro de Estudios de Oriente Medio de la Fundación Promoción Social de la Cultura in Madrid. Thank you. I practiced that. Thank you very much, Mr. Shahadi, and he'll be introducing our keynote speaker.
Okay, thank you, Julia, and wonderful Spanish pronunciation. Now, it's a very risky business having to introduce Nassim Taleb twice in to an audience that knows him so well, and that's here. So we all know that Nassim has, for his sins, spent 20 years as a derivatives trader and in the city, and then he repented and went to and became a philosopher and a mathematician to in a way to redeem himself. So now his books, you all know them, they've been translated into 36 languages. But I also have developed a definition of political risk, especially for this audience. I think the definition of political risk is bringing Nassim Taleb to a room full of economists, political scientists, and men with suits and ties. So I give you Nassim. Thank you.
I'm honored to be here and actually even surprised to be invited, but you know, you never know. So this is my lecture. So if you don't mind, so I just jotted down what I want to talk about, and I realize. So the first thing let's talk about is data analytics, data, that kind of stuff. Okay, and see, and talk about unpredictability by following the logical steps. Okay, how many of you think that you can use data to predict, you know, systematically what's going on? All right, very good. Are you aware of something, a field called finance? All right. How many correlation did we have in 2007 in finance before the crisis, in your opinion? The correlation matrix of finance, to tell you how much data we had. We had data, and when you compute covariance matrix of the world, how large do you think it was? How big do you think? Sorry? How much?
Correlation of data.
Yeah, how many correlation? How many? Okay, keep going. All right. Between half a billion and a billion correlations we had in finance, you had before the data. So this data is not what we needed, okay, what we wanted. And effectively, I went and testified in Washington against spending more money on data, like, you know, to get more confused by data. And a Congress person, actually a congressman, he told me, with a little bit of scorn, Mr. Taleb, when you cross the street, you don't look at stuff. I told him that's exactly what I do. When I cross the street, I remove data. Because you have a trillion pieces of information, and all I'm interested in crossing the street, I'm not interested in the eye colors of every driver or in the chemical composition of every item around. I'm only interested in large items that are moving. Okay, so pretty much it's called via negativa. So the more data you put in, of course, the less you're going to see that. Anyway, so let me, first I'm going to present the problem that they've had in economics for ages, still not cured for reasons that I'll introduce, called skin in the game, lack of skin in the game. In other words, they're not the people paying for their mistakes. And then we discuss the notion of fragility in place of predictive analytics, because fragility is much more measurable and much more rigorous an approach than trying to just confuse people by making predictions that cause them to take more risk. So let me start with the notion of fat tails. Okay. You randomly select two people from the world, and you end up, their total height is 4 meters and 28 centimeters, less than total, okay, for two people. What is, I don't know, it would be in feet, very tall, okay, the total. What's the most likely combination you're going to have? One person is 3 meters, the other one is 1 centimeter, 1 meter and 20? No, what is it? Sorry?
Most people are on the average.
Okay, so the two of them have to be, the larger deviation, the two of them have to be 2 meters and 14 centimeters each. That's very rare, but any combination that's not this, to give you the total, would be even more of a rare event, okay? That's simple. Now you randomly select two people on planet Earth, and they have a net worth of $42 million. Okay. What's the most likely combination you have between these two? Let's give me numbers. Most likely. Sorry?
10 to 1.
Most likely? Okay. So it's going
to
be 41,990,000 and 10K. All right? That's the most likely combination. All right? This explains the problem of what I call fat tails. Now, so can someone based on this define fat tails? I just sort of gave an intuitive mathematical definition. Typically, a good mathematical definition can be expressed with simple examples, of course, but can someone formalize it? Give me this. What is fat tail? And then we can identify it and see the consequences of that. Yes?
But just higher odds of extreme outcomes.
You don't have higher odds of extreme outcomes. You have lower odds of extreme outcomes. Right? For example, the fewer, in a very, very fat-tailed world, the fewer rich people, but those who are rich are very, very rich. So effectively, the odds of deviations drop, which is the biggest mistake in identifying. Like when I was talking, when I wrote a book called The Black Swan, everybody said Taleb is saying black swan are more common. I said, no, they're not more common, they're more consequential. It means they're less frequent, but more consequential. If you talk about inequality, all right. If one person has all the wealth, that would maximum fat tails. All right. One person has all the wealth, then you wouldn't say, well, there are more people in the tails. There's only one person in the tails. In fact, can someone give me the definition of fat tails? A different one? Another one?
The end of the distribution.
No. This is too technical and. Correct, but technical. Something more fundamental, actually, that's helpful. Okay, when you have a lot of data, most of the properties are explained by the smallest amount of observations. That's the definition. Okay, in other words, if you take how many days you've been working on Wall Street, these are the variations. For banks, for example, one day explain the bulk of the volatility. You see? Maximum fat tails, one day explains everything. You see? As if we take, for example, common examples in finance, when you look at finance, the world of finance, almost everything is fat tailed in the sense that small number of companies represent the bulk of the sales. We have 800,000 approved drugs on the market, of which 100,000 are available worldwide to be purchased. Of these, how many drugs represent the bulk of the sales? Very, very small, between 5 and 10, the profits, even smaller. Take the book business. You have 1 million manuscripts on the market for in novels and fiction. Most people who write books in America, I don't know about Europe, they usually call them, they work for Starbucks. So that's about a million. There are a million authors of in English language of nonfiction novel, of which 20,000 will be published. And how many will represent half the sales? How many books? Sorry. Give me numbers. She said 10. She said 5. Both are correct. Somewhere between 5 and 35, depending on if a lady from Edinburgh comes back or not. All right. So you get the idea. So this is pretty much so what's happening. Okay, so Fat Tales is when a small number of observation cause the major effect on the property. Okay. Something you learn in school. This is my second lecture in this room. I usually, contrary to what you think, I don't lecture a lot. But when I was here, I criticized something they teach in school called the law of large numbers, which I told them automatically whenever you hear it used or you hear something called linear regression, equate it with bullshit, right? And let me explain why. Because if you're sampling, you need a vast, it doesn't work in a real world. Small number of observation deviations, people would call them outliers, determine all the properties. If you're sampling wealth in America or in the world, right, you sample the first 100 million Indians, right, not going to give you the average, right, unless you hit on a few top people. And if you know that Bill Gates, for example, is wealthier than the bottom billion or something, right, so you get the idea of fat tails. So that's sort of what I mean by fat tails. And it has consequences all across. There are domains, like this one, that are not fat-tailed, and that's the rule. The rule is when you have large deviation, okay, the average and the maximum are close to each other. Okay? And this one is when you have large deviation, one observation typically will represent the bulk of the maximum is what counts. Actually, you can get most of the properties from the maximum, or the second, or the third, or the first 10, or first whatever. But you can have a billion people. You want to get the total wealth of the planet. You get sample the one top 1%, you get more than 50%. Okay? Don't tell the tax authorities, because in fact, numbers show about between 40 and 70%. All right? So you get the idea. Okay? That's what I mean, fat tail. And there's a super fat tail. If you take violence, small number of conflicts represent the bulk of people who died in history, for example. Okay, that's super fat tales. You have two classes of things, death by knives and death by nuclear weapons, or death by violent, by big arms. Although sometimes on the contagion, death by knives can be like this. Okay, now. Second point, why the world is becoming more and more fat-tailed. Something called, I don't know if you've heard of it, called globalization. Okay, so you can imagine Google in the 18th century starting in a garage dorm and running the world, okay? It's not. So small advantages, winner-take-all effects come from that. And the dangers with that is that in the ecology, for example, the diversity in nature is proportional to the size of an island, for example, or a continent. A large continent will have many more species than an island, but will have a lot more. A large continent will have fewer per square meter. So, and you lose that diversity. And then, of course, now variables that we discovered 2007 are becoming more and more fat-tailed. In other words, you have fewer crises, but when they happen, they're deeper. Unpredictability, that's probably what's behind unpredictability. That you have nothing happening and then a big problem, called the turkey problem. And the turkey problem, because a turkey is fed by a butcher for 1,000 days, and every day confirms to the statistical department of the turkey that the butcher loves turkeys with increased statistical confidence, until Thanksgiving minus 2 days, or I don't know about Massachusetts, 3 days, you have a big surprise for the turkey, right? And a huge revision of belief, and then you can see the statistical machinery didn't work. That's pretty much what's happening on the fat tails. We need different machinery, or at least you can tell yourself that the mean is not visible using conventional methods. By sampling the mean, you don't get the mean. There's a book by a guy called Steven Pinker of A Drop of Violence, and when we looked at data, we realized two things. Number one, that he was wrong. He didn't know how to compute the data. And the second thing, if anything, is the rise of violence, but more concentrated. So if you take history, it's fewer and deeper. That's pretty much fat-tailed. And the conventional test statistics don't work for that. Okay, now, this is number one. And this pretty much explains why if you throw garbage after garbage of data, it's not going to work. But you can see extremes from data. So if you can use data, big data for extremes, only take extremes. Or for targeted thing, you ask a question, does he know anyone who has a beard without a mustache? All right, it's very good for terrorism, but it's not good to predict the socioeconomic events. Okay, except then after the fact, I mean, it's like predicting catalyst, all right? You can't, you know, you're not predicting, and then when you have a like a bridge collapsing, people, you know, don't analyze in engineering, you don't analyze the colors of the last truck that was on it that may have caused the collapse. You look at how fragile the bridge is. Okay, so this is so far my idea. And here now let's talk about something, skin in the game and moral hazard. You've heard of a place called Wall Street. All right, this is very generalized actually, even outside Wall Street. If you make, you know, banks, they like to make money steadily, all right? On their fat tails, you don't see, because I said large numbers operate very slowly on the fat tails. Very, very, very slowly. Okay, you need vastly more data to figure out if someone is really making money. Yet, corporation, everybody, they get a bonus, something called a B. If you make money for a year, you get a bonus at your end, no? So, you make money year one, you get a bonus. Year two, you get another bonus. Year three, if you live in New York, then suddenly all your jokes become funny. All right, you make money 3 years in a row. You get more and more money under management. The bank gets bigger, they expand. Okay, and then they continue, a lot of bees. And then comes a point when you have a turkey problem, right? When, hey, you know what? The Thanksgiving one is too the equivalent for the bank. 1982, banks lost more money than the history of banking. And we didn't even have bonuses then at the time, right? More in the history of money center banking on one event. 2007, 2008, $4.7 trillion before, of course, the taxpayer came to rescue them, okay, in an implicit way. And, of course, here, what people do is they write a letter saying the odds of this event are so low that we can see it, and surely there's a sentence, surely is as much of a surprise to us as it was to you. That was in 1998 when long-term capital management blew up, and you saw it again in 2007, 2008 with absolutely no linguistic evolution. Same sentence, all right? Now this, I'm generalizing this to the following. Any situation in which you had the upside without the downside, you're invited to fool people with statistical properties of hidden risks that blow up rarely. And then using the Markowitz, all that bullshit, people will give you here, will tell you that it's very safe, when in fact it's hidden risk and you cannot make these claims based on the structure of the portfolio. So with time, those who survive, well, the minute corporations go to the market, they start developing this payoff. Visible profits and steady, and hidden losses not borne by them. I call that the Bob Rubin trade, $120 million collected from Citibank. And when Citibank happened, he said, well, it was so unexpected. He didn't return the $119 million he should return, all right? He kept, you know, keep one for the drivers and stuff like that, but no, $120 million, okay? So I called that, I said, you know. John Gotti, for example, the mafia, they never made that money. Okay, same thing happened recently after the crisis. I don't know if you heard JP Morgan, the whale. Well, same thing, all these people are getting $30 million of bonuses on something that really was hiding risk, and of course they lost it all. And then they spun a story and people kept their previous bonuses. No clawback, all right, or minor clawback if it ever happened once in Swiss Bank, all right. So, but this you can generalize to any profession.
Ones that are more popular.
Sorry? Someone said something? No, you have your microphone on. But feel free to interrupt if you're angry or something, you know what I'm saying. So here we have a class of thing, and I call it no skin in the game. If you have skin in the game at all times, you don't have that problem. Okay? This sort of explains, this kind of setup explains the modernity. Modernity was people getting benefits from an action and with the adverse effect not being affecting them because they're not visible, they're delayed, and they hit them later, okay? And you can generalize to a lot of situations in which, say you're a bureaucrat, you're gonna do something that improves your year-end job assessment, but then you hide risk, and then of course when things blows up, you say, oh, it's unexpected, okay? And so you have an invitation to have steady thing rather than volatility. And effectively, based on this principle, you're gonna see when you look at countries at anything that's very volatile, when things are very volatile, guess what? They're more stable. When things are steady, they're very stable. There's something, people in finance are definitely, I mean, it's like a generalized fraud, because if you look at a metric called Sharpe ratio, which is average return divided by standard deviation of return. The first thing, the standard deviation of return doesn't work under fat tails or in measuring risk. The ones with highest, the funds from Lehman Brothers, the firm that went bust, Bear Stearns, not Lehman Brothers, Bear Stearns, the funds, the highest funds, the ones that went bust, were from Bear Stearns. They had never lost money until they lost money. Pure turkey problem, okay? All right, so now I've set up, I've explained unpredictability, I've explained fat tails, I explained how people tend to position themselves on delayed blow-ups if you have a job assessment, no morals, and no skin in the game. Hedge fund, incidentally, you don't have that problem. You know why? Why? They're forced, exactly, he said it. He said forced to, a hedge fund manager is forced to eat his own cooking. So they have usually 50% of their money in their fund. And when they lose money, they've lost any day, more than 50 times what the next largest client has in their fund in proportion of their net worth. It's the same thing of why, now skin in the game is very important because, for example, helicopter pilots, there are two dimensions of skin in the game. The first dimension is what I call the crux of randomness, is the agency problem. And that's sort of known in economics, but given that economics doesn't know about fat tails, there's a fat tail twitch to it. But helicopter pilots, for example, in Brazil, requested that helicopter maintenance people take random rides on helicopters. And sure enough, okay, the thing improved, okay. But the dimension of skin in the game that I'm investigating now is completely different, is evolutionary, in the following sense. A lot of people engage in this, they're the fools of randomness. You have the crooks of randomness, you have the fools of randomness. A lot of people believe their own bullshit. You see the idea? Like, if you look at economists, they believe their own stuff. It's not like they're gaming the system. And when a measure is wrong, you know, their objective function isn't, you know, that they're not penalized by their own mistakes. So, but in nature, you don't have that. In nature, anyone who endangers others, all right, okay, you don't have evolution unless those who endanger others are themselves bear the same risk. So let's say, have you been on highways? There are highways here to get here? Okay, go on a highway. You remember that pilot, that crazy guy, that pilot? Okay, anybody could do it on a highway. You don't need to be on a plane. You can kill 30 people. You can go wild and kill 30 people on a highway, no? You go against traffic and kill 30 people. Why aren't there that many of these? Can someone tell me? Sorry? No, it's not because they have skin in the game. They could be crazy and not have skin in the game. I'm not at the crux of randomness, agency problem. I'm at the fools of randomness. Why? Because they're dead. Like this, the guy who killed 100 and some people, he's dead. So you can't have that higher ratio in the population of these people because they end up killing themselves. You know, when they kill others, they kill themselves as well. You see, they filtered out of the system. You see, so it's like entrepreneurs who make mistakes, they're dead. You see, they're dead. So this is pretty much what people don't realize as a filtering tool, is that you're because in an opacity, in a very opaque environment, sorry. Yeah, but there are exceptions, but it helps that they're dying as well and in the operation, you see? It does help, but I mean, of course you have exceptions with ISIS. But typically, traditionally, the ratio of people who are bellicose in the population has stayed lower, you know, than the level you need to blow up the planet. because the nuts like Alexander, Napoleon, and these people would go to battle, would stay at the front line in battle. Hannibal, the nut, a complete nut. If you look at it, there's people say make him a hero. He's a complete irrational fellow. All right, Hannibal was in front line. Okay, he was first in battle, and that was the all these. So that's traditionally what has happened. True, I mean, suicide bombers kill themselves, so they filtered out, they kill other people. But I don't think that we can talk about suicide bombers as a real danger to the system as a whole, given that the number of casualties coming from them is still very, very minute. Every day in America, 7,000 people die. And say multiply by 20 to get the number of people who die on the planet, and count how many of these comes from suicide bombers, and you realize that we're still talking about low risk. Much bigger risk. Okay, we're talking about skin in the game and as a filtering tool for people who endanger others. Okay, so we're not judging whether terrorism is dangerous or not. I believe it is dangerous, but that's another. I believe it's very, very dangerous psychologically and stuff like that. I'm talking about the mechanism of filtering people in a pool. You see, as a mechanism of filtering, I was a pit trader, and the mechanism of filtering. There was a mechanism of filtering, and people would go bust with their own money. They wouldn't survive hiding risk, and effectively, traders don't like to hide risk. What happened is they claw this. Okay, now. All right, so now I've given 2 points. Let me move into fragility. This is why I was telling you why you cannot measure risk. And effectively, you do a very simple test. And it's a very, very trivial test. You know, when Greenspan went to Congress to tell them the crisis didn't happen, the crisis, he apologized for why the crisis happened. He told them these events never happened before. Nobody had the presence of mind among Congress people to tell them, but you never died before. And effectively, there's a very simple test to do that. The test is you take an axis of events, tail events, between time, say, t minus 1 and t plus 1. Okay? If the past predicted the future, you would see tail events like this. In fact, what you see is a bunch of tail events here without successors and a bunch of tail events here without predecessors. Which tells us if you do a very simple empiricism, which takes about 10 minutes on Excel, for those who use Excel, okay, and about half a minute on Mathematica. So if you can run that and then tell Mr. Greenspan that it's a silly thing to say that tail events have to have predecessors. It's just that typically they don't. Otherwise, people don't get harmed by them. So you can't use that as an excuse. You have to now look at the system and think like engineers. I happen to be a professor of engineering, which is the only job I ever wanted. All right? Why? Because there's no bullshit in engineering. All right? So now let's move into engineering. All right. Okay. So I just wrote a paper. I wrote something for the Rand Corporation. Okay. And then it was a version of it, dumbed down, diluted, transformed, journalistified, destroyed, edited, debased, disfigured, of course. Appeared in Foreign Affairs, all right? I don't know if you've heard of that place. I had the misfortune of publishing that version there. And let me tell you what we did with the thing. So we start with the fact that people want to see what country is going to blow up next. Okay? So fragility theory is vastly more effective. You look at a bridge, you know what bridge is fragile or not. Okay? And we have metrics to figure out what's fragile, what's not. So the whole idea, that was my idea on the black swan, which people don't understand, is I'm not predicting these events. I'm just describing the phenomenon and saying, hey, you know, how do you get in trouble? Okay? How do you build a system that can resist the black swan? And effectively, that's my last book, and everything I'm working on is fragility, metrics of fragility, because there's universality of fragility. So we define now fragility as something that does not like disorder. Okay? That's simple. That's the definition of fragility. We still haven't defined disorder yet. We can define disorder. Okay, how do you define disorder? You walk to a physicist, he tell you entropy. I say, I'm sorry, it's confusing. Okay, let's go. You go to a mathematician who would define this order as sigma, right, or whatever, as scale of distribution. You go to a finance person and tell you standard deviations, and so, okay, say, all right. We go to someone and say time breaks things. So you think about it, yes, there is a metric that's universal to disorder. And there's a sensitivity to that disorder that's pretty much invariant. There's a beautiful thing in mathematics is that if you have a metric that's represented in some way, it cannot be contradicted in another discipline that approach it from a different mathematical method. So they had to be unified. And all you have to do is prove one, you proved all the others. That's the beauty of mathematics, whether you use differential equation or integration or other techniques, or probability theory or engineering, you get to the same thing. And the definition doesn't like disorder. Okay, and looking at a coffee cup doesn't like disorder. And what doesn't like disorder has to have this property? Shocks, you remember this graph? All right, shocks, this is a coffee cup, all right, the health of the coffee cup. You have shocks, all right? It doesn't benefit from shock. It doesn't have upside. It has bigger downside than upside. Okay? That's simple. That's the definition of fragility. So we came up with this definition of local fragility, all right? After the coffee cup is broken, it's no longer fragile. Okay? And there's another representation we can have of a coffee cup. It doesn't like the disorder. Is this is a coffee cup. This is an intensity of shock. You tap. And then, boom, it breaks. And now it doesn't care anymore, all right? So this is known as concave. Second order effect that's accelerating. Okay. Complicated, but it's a necessary relation. It's not like it's something you thought of, it has to be like this. It's a necessary relation from the fact of not liking disorder. If you don't like disorder, the rule is as follows. A shock of 10% harms you more than twice a shock of 5%. Okay. I don't know if many of you have driven cars. When you go home, drive your car into the wall 50 times at 1 mile per hour. And then try it once at 50 miles per hour and compare, right? And then we can talk about it again. And then you'll see that we're fragile because shocks, right, are disproportionately harmful to us, okay? So we just that with that that notion of fragility, which didn't exist before because you have to be vicious or an option trader or obsessed with coffee cups to figure it out, it so happened that all option traders know about it. We call it negative convexity or concavity, right? And also if you have reactions, that's accelerating. So if there's an antifragile, I show the graph of a stone. I don't know how much more time we have, but this is a stone, and this is a harm function, okay? A stone of a kilogram, if hits me on the head with a stone of 100 pounds, I'm harmed a lot more than 100 times a stone of 1 pound. You see? So there's an acceleration. And that acceleration determines it. Okay? When you have an acceleration like that, I'd much rather have one stone at 25 pounds, okay, rather than one at 10 and one at 40. Okay. How much more time do I have before the?
Any more time?
I have. Okay. So this is during the conversation. I'll continue, but I'll give you 2 more minutes. All right. So this is acceleration. Okay. And the rule is as follows. This is concave. This is convex. This is, you know the difference. This is bad. This is good. In other words, if you have the second order effect, your reaction to anything, to debt, you increase debt, you're much more fragile. If you have $1 billion debt in a country versus $100 billion debt, you're not 100 times more fragile than $100 billion debt, you're 10 million times more fragile, you see? So with this, we can do metrics. So if you want to get bored, read my paper, as I discovered, disfigured, blah, 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 in foreign affairs, okay? But I was very lucky because nothing can be as bad as something called the Harvard Business Review, where they transform, their rule is you should not have more than one idea per paper with an average of zero, all right? It was a target average of zero. So with foreign affairs, they may tolerate one, an average, all right? But dumb it down, you know, to not explain these things. All right, so this is sort of the gist of it, and I know that I haven't explained enough for you to be bored with it, but at the same time, you know, this is a beginning. I mean, you can look it up and continue with the idea that there are two kind of portfolios. A portfolio where bad news, you lose money. Portfolio with bad news, you make money. One is convex, one is concave. One I call anti-fragile, one I call fragile. One likes disorder, one dislikes disorder. So when we look at countries, you see, hey, size makes you more fragile to disorder. Size of unit, not necessarily, you know, size of country, size of decision-making unit. Corporation, same thing. Debt makes you vulnerable to disorder. What else? The bunch of things makes you just focusing one commodity rather than have more than one commodity vulnerable to disorder. So the idea is vulnerable to disorder, which we can measure, which we can explain, is pretty much a universal definition of fragility that we can apply to countries, and it's not predictive. You see, I can tell that this is, if there's an earthquake here, this will do better than a computer. Great, thank you for listening to me. I'll keep this because I will continue the lecture as we're.
Thank you very much, Nassim. And there's one thing I wanted to add, is that on the way here, I discovered that Nassim has a rating by Uber, by taxi drivers, by Uber drivers of 4.9. So we know he's nice to taxi drivers.
Yeah, no, but that's the thing I'm proud of, because a lot of people have rating of 5 with one ride or two rides. And I've been on 3 years worldwide on Uber, so this is the difference. So that's my, yeah, maybe the only piece on my resume that I care about is, is my Uber rating.
We have about 15 minutes.
But also, I have a rating of -1 with policy people in Washington. And I want to decrease it, you know.
We have about 20 questions and 15 minutes. And I want to slip my comment in as a follow-up to the gentleman who spoke about ISIS. There's a panic in the West about returning, about ISIS jihadis who return from Syria or from the field.
Okay, no, I have no clue about that. This is so minor currently as a source of risk. The bigger source of risk is debt. Let's talk about real things. Like airplanes crashing make the front line, you know, of the newspaper. ISIS makes the front line of newspaper. Unless you live in the area, or like me, you're from Lebanon, all right, it's not a big... people talk about it a lot, but if you look at the risks we face on a daily basis, the real risks are not ISIS. That's bullshit. The thing to think about, the real risk was Ebola. Because Ebola can spread. You see, Ebola can accelerate, can spread, these kind of things. And the next Ebola will be facing the first time in history with an epidemic that flies on British air, you see, and of course Delta, and gets bad food on United, right, bad treatment by flight attendants. So that's a problem. We never face it because of, so epidemics follow this mode. So when people tell me, let's talk about risk, the first thing I talk about is, if ISIS or someone else maybe can accelerate it, but it could be naturally coming, is an epidemic.
Okay, so I have some questions here from the audience. So I think one of them you've already sort of answered, because it says, can you discuss some examples in the world that are fragile and that may be in the fat tails of coming events?
Okay.
So that's
let me tell you one thing about fragility here, what I can explain. It can tell us that the Soviet Union did not collapse because of political regime, but because of size, because of centralization. It can tell us because you can compare China to Singapore, and you realize the size effect is monstrous. Okay. Then again, a lot of people don't quite realize the history. And when you discuss the history of Italy in the 300 years before the unification, it was a lot of turmoil, but low-grade turmoil, which makes things stable, you see. When it unified is when bad things start happening, when they had the big two wars and stuff like that. So effectively, the there's this myth about where the risks are that are, when I wrote Fooled by Randomness, I was talking about the regular people not understanding risk. And later on, I started talking about psychologists of risk not understanding risk, or academics not understanding risk. And that, this is where things started, you know, I started getting hate mail but from academic, because they start hating me because I'm saying they don't understand risk, you see. So when we talk about the spate of risk facing us today in this room, the first thing you got to think about is the real thing that can harm us and spread uncontrollably, which is epidemics or biological agents spread by people, not the ISIS with a bunch of guys on YouTube, you know.
So this is, in a way, also related to the next question, which is, should we still be thinking about risks on a country level or only on a country level? And how does fragility apply to transnational phenomena like Al-Qaeda, cybersecurity? Cybersecurity.
I'm a very simple... cybersecurity is a big problem. Yeah. But cybersecurity, luckily, we have things going for us, is that people are so paranoid about it. Banks spend 5% of their money on cybersecurity. And you have hackers all the time. And let me tell you what the interesting thing about the computer industry. They're smart people, all right? They're very, very smart people, because they're not over-educated PhDs and stuff like that. They know, for example, let me give you an example. When I finished Antifragile, a lot of people wrote to me, and then I started engaging with them, and I discovered that effectively, they were doing things that I thought I discovered. Like, for example, there's something called the Chaos Monkey on a part by Netflix. Netflix every day engineers failures. So their systems are, it's sort of like the Saudi Arabians don't try every day to invade Saudi Arabia, all right? Okay, pay people to invade, hey, let's see. But Netflix every day has an army of agents, trying to destroy a system. And they know if they self-destroy, so they discover vulnerability. So they understand very well this notion in Antifragile that I extended time here, that things that experience a lot of variability are a lot more stable. So I'm not that worried about cyber as much as the breathing. You see, when you get an Uber taxi and the guy had a passenger before you, these kind of things are more worrisome. But we looked closely at cybersecurity, and effectively, these are the risks we identify, but we're doing so much about cybersecurity that we don't have to worry too much. The only thing I think may happen in the future is the cost of controlling, you know, these risks may go up quite a bit. You see, like people spending more and more of their budget on cybersecurity.
And there's indirect costs as well.
Sorry?
Cybersecurity can slow things down.
It is. For example, I went to London last week, the first time I used the credit card and used it in foreign country, puffed things, they stopped, right? So they have a type one, they have a very, 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 very paranoid attitude toward that.
Okay, so the next question is, how does your fragility framework compare with systems thinking?
I didn't understand systems thinking.
I didn't either, but I was trying to read it as though I understood it.
No, I tried. No, there is a Complex System Institute, and there's a member here, and we work together on taxonomies and stuff, on scaling. But I don't understand systems thinking because I bought a few books that don't understand the word. I don't understand things unless they're explained to me mathematically. You see, so I'm a trader. So unless I see a contract, you know, you get paid here a dollar, you lose a dollar if this happens, that kind of thing. And then like resilience, all these things. So I don't understand. So I'm not saying anything bad. I don't understand it. Right. So I'd much rather I like the rigor of mathematical framework for things and may fit, contradict. I have no idea.
Now, this one, we need to know who asked it because yeah. it's a trick question.
Yeah.
So what's your blind spot? Or your blind spots?
I would like to know them. I mean, I have the whole idea is if you know your blind spot, it's no longer a blind spot.
That's true. Okay.
Yeah.
I did.
That's sort of like a the liar's paradox or something. If you knew your blind spot, it wouldn't be a blind spot. But in other words, do you make an effort to look at blind? Okay. My point is, I'm developing something that probably improves, like in stress testing, a little more acceleration, detection of acceleration, improves stress testing a bit. So a little improvement here and there, all right? I'm not trying to solve the problems of the world. You don't get there. With a very simple framework. The good thing about fragility theory is you can touch a lot of things and work with a lot of scientists. And it's mostly cited my work in physics for some weird reason. So it's very narrow, and I want to improve from here to here. I don't want to try to find, you know, the flaws in the world and stuff like that.
Right. Now, is statistics a useless science, or are there some redeemable principles in statistics?
I mean, everything now, the big mistake Hilbert said, he said any science that develops, okay, becomes applied mathematics. And if it's not applied mathematics yet, it's not yet a science. Or that was Hilbert. And I believe him, but I'm going to change it. And I say any science that develops properly becomes probability theory, right? Statistics is one branch of applied, statistics is the probability theory is what cooking is to chemistry. You see the idea. Is cooking, and the problem with statistics is the way it's used now mechanistically. A lot of people use statistic mechanistics. So my major work is not the inserto. The inserto is a philosophical thing. Is the parallel work that I have is about 1,000 pages, 500 unreadable outside finance, outside derivatives, and 500 pages now in something called silent risk, which I made available on a way for anybody to buy, publish, do whatever you want, sell, do, you know, put a nice cover, whatever, okay? So a silent risk well formatted is on the web for free. And in silent risk, you go through deep what's happening. We discovered one thing with GMOs, like, you know, when a scientist, when someone does experiments and stuff like that, they go to a statistician who puts a stamp. Like, you remember there used to be ad for Haynes, they don't say it's Haynes unless I say it's Haynes, an old lady, and stamps it. So the statistician puts a stamp. But typically the statistician doesn't really care about biology, he looks at the numbers and says, okay, this is converged, all right? So it's not enough, because statistics has never made claims to be dealing with tail events. A statistician tells you we are studying things with a 98% confidence interval. The problem is, if you're doing airplanes with 98 confidence intervals, it's an airplane that's statistically safe with that intervals, you'd have between 900 and 5,000 airplane crashes a day, you see? So the risk management is not completely in a tail, way beyond what the statisticians have been touching traditionally, or the tools, so it's a completely different set of tools. And these tools are not refined yet, they don't exist. But there's a group of people in ETH in Zurich working on it. There are a bunch of people working in a lot of areas on formalizing a method and approach. Just like what statistics is a probability theory,
yeah.
Risk as an application to probability theory. And a lot of the people have come from insurance. So is it useful? It's imperative, and we're controlled by it. Because a lot of problem is the verbalistic cannot reveal the risk. You have to format it in a way. And you realize how people make a lot of mistakes.
So how does bad data affect your thesis? This is a question from someone who's saying that they're using data to understand tails and distributions. And what about questioning the data itself?
It's not important.
What do you do about bad data?
When you work with the tails, what happens in the body of the distribution is of no relevance to you. Like people what you look at, what we say peak over threshold and stuff like that, pot methods and stuff. You take the maxima of data. So, if I, for example, Steve Pinker wrote 800-page book with paid data every page, and you look at it, you say it's entertainment, because if you're really doing your job on fat tails, you'd have half a page, right, with one thing taking the maxima and seeing the behavior of the maxima. So. There's something called the large deviation theory, another branch called the distribution of extrema, okay, extreme value theory or different names. So there's a few branches that deal with tails, and when you deal with tails, you deal with tails. Let me give you an idea. When O.J. Simpson, he killed his wife, no? All right, so you don't say, oh, the other day he ate breakfast, he didn't kill anyone, all right? You only look at one piece of data when he killed his wife. You don't look at the other. You don't judge a character based on a regular, all right? You judge a character based on the tail events, okay? So therefore, I'm not interested in what he eats for breakfast or what he does. So I'm only interested in when he kills his wife, what does he do, you know, when he kills his wife, right? That's sort of the story with O.J. Simpson. Likewise, with when you look at events, you look at the tail, the large deviation, the Lamar information, and there's an error people make, and there's something, a theorem actually, say that we show that a million pieces of data, all right, can be anecdote. N of one, if it's in a tail, okay, is information. Most people think that data is information. One can be information, and a million can be no information, okay, depending on how far you are in the tails.
Wow, so is there any big data platform that you worked with that
again, the whole idea of big data offends me because, well, there's a problem with big data. Let me explain it to you.
So, yeah.
Let me explain
no,
the
don't,
large
don't,
D.
Don't hit me.
Okay. Let me explain the large D problem in big data, okay? If you generate a covariance matrix, okay, you generate a covariance matrix, okay, 100 with 100 units, okay, so say D equal 100, and you have N equal 1,000, all right? Yes. Randomly, you generate randomly data, you're going to see, we just did it with the eigenvalues. How many spurious correlation would you see, would you say, Joe Norman?
How many spurious correlations?
Yeah. Well, you're likely to have 50 pieces of whatever, no? Exactly. So you will have the random data. So what happened is that, and this is discovered was discovered a long time ago by people in finance, and then later on in medicine, where epidata, when you look at big data in medicine, there's a guy called Ioannidis who figured it out. He said, if I have the larger the data, look at it. If I add a piece of data, I have n times n minus 1 divided by 2. This is every time I add a dimension, okay, every time I add a dimension, I have more spurious correlation likely to happen. So the number of spurious correlation are convex. This is bad correlation, convex to data, right? Convex to D, to the dimensionality. It's called cursor dimensionality. To mitigate it, you need to increase the data points per variable. And unfortunately, we don't have enough of these, you see? So we have a large, what is called the large D, small n problem. So you're likely to see spurious correlation. Like, and this was discovered in epidemiology, rediscovered in epidemiology by a guy called Ioannidis 5 years after recent finance discovered it, that after fooled by randomness, that when you have, when I said fooled by randomness, the more data I have, the more likely I am likely to find a stock that correlates perfectly with your blood pressure, okay? So that's a problem of, now how do you clean this up? By having a large N, small d, but N you can't manufacture. N. So D is increasing too fast. That's the problem of data. So this is why you got a data in the hands of people who think, hey, more data is good and stuff like that. It's very dangerous. This is why it is very, very dangerous. Let me repeat the point. You have variables. I'm adding variables, and variables are swelling every day. And every variable I add, okay, creates a billion spurious correlations, you see? And inference is the thing with Gaussian would go root n, which is concave, you see? So you have root n, information grows at root n, so slowly with n, and very quick, and bad information grows very quickly with d. So this is what, if I'm looking at big data, I can find two correlations tomorrow that look very plausible on something that's plain bullshit. Yes?
Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
All right.
No.
The notion of spurious correlations is not unknown to data scientists. So I guess I asked the question.
Yeah.
And the reason I was asking is because even with that, I still think, and I've seen at least just many, just one here, the value of using big data. data, so I'm curious why you...
Okay, there are two problems. The first one is under fat tails, data grows much more slowly than n, all right, than root n. That's the first thing, you see. You need a lot more data, a lot more n, okay, under fat tail. And we just verified it with the eigenvalues explode under fat tails. That's the first one. That's technical. The second one is I discussed it in Antifragile to answer that question. I said there's something called the Bonferroni upper bound that tells you the more variables you have, you put high threshold on Bonferroni, and there's something called the Marasenko-Pasteur bound for stuff. But the problem is that researchers, and this is, I put it in my chapter on ethics, of all things. I said the problem of ethics is that I can, if I want to write a paper, you see, I test till I find something that fits, and then I give you a statistically significant thing, you see. I'm not going to tell you, it's like hiding risk. I'm not going to reveal to you how many times I've tried, you see. So the two problems are fat tails and ethics.
So I'll let you go. I would love to introduce you to some data scientists who are very good at what they
do. Okay, are they rich?
They're getting there, I'd say.
No. Okay. My definition of someone who says I work a lot with data and I can predict, I tell them, do you work for a living or no? The minute they say yes, I discount it. Because someone who really has, if we have the hang they claim to have on the data, all right, they'd be owning a piece of real estate of the state of Massachusetts and stuff like that. And that was something we noticed, that was a rule that we had in finance early on. Do they work for a living? Yes, no. If they work for a living, then it's suspicious because they're giving you equations and smoke and data. This is skin in the game again. But I discussed that in skin in the game.
Even if they work for a living and they have gold taps on the jacuzzi of their private airplane, they can fail in the end.
No. In other words, you can tell if someone has... The person who is the most sophisticated by far in data is a Renaissance guy, and they only use it for short-term trading. You see? For inventory. So there's a finance fellow here. Yes?
I'm sorry, I don't have a phone, so if you wouldn't mind, I just ask one. So, it's a wonderful...
Wait for the microphone, because it's being recorded, please.
Sorry, thank you. And it's such a wonderful formalization of this idea, and I'm right with you intuitively, you know. But do you worry that you're going to give them this great model and they're going to misuse it? I mean, is the problem not in the math, but in, like, psychology, you know, hubris and self-delusion?
In big data, as I answered them, there are two problems. The first one is in the math. The math is not in the methods to control, they say, for multiple testing, all right, doesn't take into account the fat tail. And the second one is the problem of ethics, okay? That's the problem of big data, is ethics. The guy comes in and writes a paper. You know that the FDA, since 2005, all right, if you tell them, I want to introduce this drug, this is an epidemiological study done on a computer, they take it, they throw it in the garbage, okay? So even if you did all the things.
But just more broadly, on the trading floor and so forth.
He has. He's a dictator here.
I think it's time to wrap up.
Yeah.
I've been getting looks from our organizer.
Yeah, maybe he has a question. Maybe he has, but he seems angry. So it's good. He seems not angry, but he seems. You get the idea.
Passionate
about it. Yeah.
I'm thinking about not just related to big data, but on the trading floor and in the banks and in life. I mean, it seems like the problems, if it's garbage in and garbage out, even into a terrific quantitative model, if it's, you know, how do we, I mean, as a you consult on policy and...
we live in Boston. It's not the trading floor. People are into inventory market making. So a lot of the profits come from the fact that they have a franchise. But we live in Boston where you have Fidelity Investment and you have the other guys. All right, and how much data, big data Fidelity Investment has, and how much data, and we know that a random fellow, you know, who works as operator on the subway, his odds of outperforming Fidelity or these guys is very high. The odds are very high, okay? So this tells you that we know this from finance, and say, hey, if they, of course, you hear of people who outperform, but overall, the finance industry is a big scam to cash in the fees from people by telling you we're using these computers for fancy stuff, but they don't outperform the market, okay, cumulatively. Of course, you're going to show you the ones that outperform and not the others. So this is where, I mean, we have enough evidence that data has not helped people in socioeconomic domain. But if you happen to be in bird flying theory, data is great, all right? Or if you're into hydrology, data is perfect. Or what else? If you're in, you see, but things that are nonlinear, data is hard. And this is, and you can see it, how much money was thrown and how many Russian scientists were flown in after the Soviet Union, how much money to try to predict one. And overall, all you hear, you have a biased version of the story, but you look at the you know.
Okay, I'm getting signals from the leadership that we should finish. And there's a question, but it looks like it's by an economist. So I'll
yeah, go ahead. No, so say yeah.
But it says that that's the last one. Okay, so the question is that if we stop using statistics,
yeah,
as the question thinks you suggest, how can we make decisions?
Okay, that's great. That's so, skin in the game.
And also, don't we have to make assumptions?
Okay, this is the kind of thing that only economists would say. I'm glad you did not disclose the name of these guys. Because they can keep supplying you with bad models and yet survive. All right, if they had skin in the game, they'd be dead. All right, and other people would be coming. And the problem is, in real life, we don't use... Let me tell you one thing I discovered, but only recently. It was recently, that is 5 years ago. I'm slow, you see. It took me 20 years to write The Black Swan. So the And Silent Risk now is its 10th year, all right. So it took me late. I discovered, I said, hey, you know what? What are the fields that are the smart fields? Where, okay, physics, okay? Do they have pages and pages of statistics? No. Why? Because there's no bullshit. They don't need to put a lot, right? So you start looking at people. The more people use statistics, the more they back it up with statistics, the more guilty they are, in fact. And if, and there's another thing that I mean, we can look at effectively, that the predictability. So much, there's this one thing that people in economics, a logic that they lose when they're in economics. If you are, let me tell you, if you are lost in Washington, D.C., and you don't have a map, and you run into an economist, you say, hey, I have no map. He goes, yeah, I have a map of Moscow, you know. All right, would you take that map of Moscow? No, so why do you take random analysis, which is plain random, all right, to make decision rather than, okay, so don't make these decisions. So what do you do? Okay, so it's like what I tell people, if you're on a plane and the pilot says we have a map of the Himalayas and we're going to the Alps, but good enough, all right, you get off the plane and you go by boat. So you calibrate. So the first axiom I have is only use statistics for decision, all right, if the statistics is reliable, right? If not, then do something. Don't take that decision. Try to be robust. That's the whole idea of fragility theory. And I suggest that economists download Silent Risk, and if he goes past the insults every five pages, right? I said when I wrote The Black Swan, 100% of firemen understood it, all right? 95% of mathematicians, 82% of physicists, this, and then 0.01% of economists understood what I was talking about, all right? So because the logic that you have in real life, in risk management, I don't have a map of Moscow in D.C., I'd rather have nothing, all right? And look, they lose it the minute you go into the classroom, okay? And I've named these things. I've named it the Stigler effect. Stiglitz, yeah. I've named a lot of things, like... Stiglitz said Fannie Mae is safe, right? And Fannie Mae blew up, and now he's lecturing us on what to do next. I mean, in the real world, you blow up, you're out of the pool, or don't exist anymore. Other people are coming to the pool, and that's evolution. He's blocking evolution.
Nassim Taleb, whatever made you.
Thank you very much.
Whatever made you take the decision to come and disturb us, we're very grateful. Oh,
great, thank you. Thanks a lot.
Two announcements before we break for coffee. First, quickly, the alumni meet and greet will be by the registration table by the exit. That's right in the main hall. You can identify the alumni by the orange sticker on their name tags. Next, we'd like to thank S&P Capital IQ for the upcoming coffee break. S&P Capital IQ is a multinational financial institution information provider headquartered in New York. S&P Capital IQ provides web-based information services that combine information on companies worldwide, along with a variety of software applications that allow financial professionals to analyze company fundamentals, build financial models, screen for investment ideas, and execute other financial research tasks. S&P Capital IQ has teamed up with Lockheed Martin to provide an analytical tool to monitor country risk indicators and geopolitical risk around the globe. They've combined Lockheed's event-driven work with client market indicators to provide a country health panel dashboard. Please pick up their handout, which is available in the main hall, for more information, and enjoy the coffee break.